Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Pharmacist of Auschwitz, The Untold Story of Victor Capesius by Patricia Posner, narrated by Julian Elfer. Introduction by Rabbi Abraham Cooper. I had the honor and privilege of knowing and working with Simon Wiesenthal, the Nazi hunter, for nearly 30 years. As a result of losing 89 members of his family in the Nazi Holocaust, and due to the unspeakable barbarity and cruelty that Simon suffered and witnessed during the Shoah, he dedicated every day from May 5, 1945, when US soldiers liberated him, more dead than alive, from the Mauthausen concentration camp, to pursuing and tracking down the mass murderers of his people. He would help hunt down some 1,100 Nazi criminals, including the man who arrested Anne Frank and her family. Justice, not vengeance, was his credo. We need convicted criminals, not martyrs for the neo-Nazi cause, Simon would tell us at the Simon Wiesenthal Center, which he established in 1977. He was a crusader for justice, who toiled virtually alone and without significant support during the Cold War years to ensure that memory would be preserved and justice would be served. Every trial would be an inoculation against hatred and a warning to generations yet unborn of man's capacity for evil against his fellow man, he would tell audiences on American campuses in the 1970s and 80s. How right this crusader for justice was. We live in a world where Holocaust denial is state policy of the mullahocracy in Iran, where Holocaust terms and imagery are inverted and abused by extremists who hate the Jewish state, where words like genocide and, yes, even Auschwitz are cynically co-opted by politicians, pundits, and even academics. Worse still is the instinct, 70 years later, to view the Shoah in the rearview mirror of history, to claim that Auschwitz has lost its relevance to our day. That is why Patricia Posner's The Pharmacist of Auschwitz, The Untold Story of Victor Capesius, is such an important and relevant work. It traces the path of an educated man, Victor Capesius, who was trained as a pharmacist, who was a well-liked salesman for IG Farben and Bayer, who knew and socialized with Jews in his native Romania before World War II. That same man would end up standing alongside Auschwitz's Angel of Death, sometimes sending people he knew in peacetime, including young Jewish twins, to their immediate deaths in the gas chambers. He also safeguarded the Nazis' stash of Zyklon B and provided drugs that would be used by doctors to perform horrific and deadly experiments on pregnant women and children. This was a man who picked through cadavers of murdered Jews in search of gold fillings and, driven by greed, dragged away heavy suitcases of gold extracted from thousands of victims. As important as tracing Capesius's Auschwitz career is, Miss Posner's reconstruction of the group trial of Nazi criminals in a West German court in the early 1960s, it included the chief aide to Auschwitz's commandant and also doctors, dentists, even capos, along with Capesius. Throughout the trial and even after his conviction and sentencing to 9 years, Capesius and the other defendants never showed remorse. Survivors who dared testify in the German court were greeted with stares of contempt by surviving Nazis who seemed disappointed that any of their victims had survived. In Capesius's case, the liar, thief and robber of the dead, he always denied his crimes, refused to take responsibility for his actions or to apologize to the Jews he murdered. He saw himself as the victim, a good person who was just following orders, a small cog who never should have been jailed in the first place. On January the 24th, 1968, less than 2.5 years into his 9-year sentence, Capesius was released from prison by Germany's highest court. After his release, Capesius's first public appearance in Göppingen was with his family at a classical concert. As he walked into the music hall, the audience broke spontaneously into enthusiastic applause. To many, including perhaps some of the ex-Nazi judges who had freed him, Capesius deserved sympathy and support. After all, to them he was just a good German who was just following orders. Patricia Posner makes sure that new generations can understand that the path he, and others like him, chose led them straight to the gates of hell and beyond. Rabbi Abraham Cooper, Associate Dean, Co-founder, Simon Wiesenthal Center, Los Angeles, California, August 2016. Author's Preface. In the spring of 1986, I went to New York's Plaza Hotel for a meeting that my husband, author Gerald Posner, had arranged at Trader Vic's, a Polynesian-themed restaurant. It was for research we were conducting into Dr. Josef Mengele, the famous Angel of Death, responsible for gruesome medical experiments at Auschwitz, the largest Nazi concentration camp. What had started as a pro bono lawsuit by Gerald on behalf of two surviving Mengele guinea pigs had turned into a biography of the Nazi fugitive. During those intervening years, we had travelled to Germany and South America, pursued the story in long-sealed archives, and also penetrated post-war neo-fascist circles that had helped Mengele stay one step ahead of Nazi hunters. The meeting at Trader Vic's was with none other than Rolf Mengele, the only child of the notorious doctor. Gerald and I waited in a dimly lit corner booth for 42-year-old Mengele to arrive. As a British Jew, I knew that if my maternal Polish grandparents had not emigrated to the United Kingdom at the turn of the 20th century, it was likely they would have ended up at a Nazi death camp. Maybe they would have died at Auschwitz, where men like Mengele reigned supreme. Little wonder that much of our Mengele research had seemed surreal to me. There had been that extremely uncomfortable and testy exchange Gerald had had in Buenos Aires with Wilfried von Orphan, a top aide to Nazi propaganda chief Joseph Goebbels, and also the publisher of a virulently anti-Semitic post-war journal in Argentina. Or the time I saw a collection of Nazi memorabilia, gifts from one of Mengele's sponsors for citizenship in Paraguay. But that all seemed quite distant now that I was about to meet Rolf Mengele. Gerald and I had discussed it many times. A child is not responsible for the sins of the father, and I knew from our work that Rolf condemned what his father did at Auschwitz and was trying hard to make amends by allowing Gerald to use his father's diaries and letters free of charge in the upcoming biography. The New York visit was in part to discuss whether Rolf might agree to talk about his father on live television. He did, with Gerald, on the Phil Donahue show that summer. Still, while my brain's rational side understood that the man I was about to meet bore no responsibility for the bone-chilling crimes committed by his paternal namesake at Auschwitz, I was nevertheless a jumble of nerves and conflicting emotions. Gerald had already met with Rolf in Germany over several weeks, and the two had developed a good rapport. I was the one now on the spot. My apprehension dissolved, though, soon after Rolf arrived. It seemed that he was as nervous as I, and that skittishness somehow helped reduce our shared anxiety. I was impressed with his sincerity in denouncing his father's crimes, and in the coming days I discovered that Mengele's atrocities had burdened his son with a legacy he did not fully understand nor embrace, and which he badly wanted to avoid passing to his own children. At one point, while discussing his father's escape from justice, we talked about the chaotic months after the war had ended in May 1945. Mengele was still in Europe and American and British forces were hunting him. It turned out he had many lucky breaks, but one that made a lasting impression on me was that in September 1945, 8 months after fleeing Auschwitz only steps ahead of the Soviet Red Army, Mengele showed up unannounced at the Munich home of a pharmacist and his wife. That unidentified pharmacist had served with Mengele on the Russian front in 1942, before Mengele's transfer to Auschwitz. But, said Rolf, the Munich pharmacist knew about his father's crimes because they shared a mutual acquaintance who had worked with Mengele at the death camp. Another pharmacist, Victor Capesius. Capesius, said Rolf, that's the pharmacist of Auschwitz. My father and Capesius were friends. I remember that moment as if it were yesterday. My first thought was, Auschwitz had a pharmacist? Over the years, between my own book projects and the many shared with Gerald, I hoped someday to write about Capesius. My desire to do so grew over time as I realized that his story, and the role he played at Auschwitz with some of Germany's biggest pharmaceutical firms, was largely untold, lost largely in the coverage of more infamous Nazis. As I gradually compiled information over the years, I discovered a compelling tale of perverted medicine and greed. Those few words 31 years ago from Rolf Mengele planted a seed that is now realized. What follows is the singular, disturbing, and at times maddening story of the pharmacist of Auschwitz. Chapter 1. Pharmacist Uncle. May 1944. Auschwitz, the Nazi high temple of industrial-scale genocide, was operating at full capacity. In a frenzied climax in its war to eradicate European Jewry, the Third Reich had set about deporting up to 800,000 Hungarian Jews to Auschwitz's gas chambers. The place that would become synonymous with mass murder was struggling to keep up with the flood of new victims. It was this chaotic setting to which Mauritius Berner, a Romanian doctor, and his wife and children arrived. The Berners and 80 of their Jewish neighbors from Hungarian-controlled Transylvania got there just before sunrise after a torturous three-day journey, packed inside a cattle car. Outside, the locks and chains were taken off and the door opened, Berner later recalled. There were huge masses of suitcases, thousands of pieces of luggage in unimaginable disorder. A phalanx of SS troops with barking Alsatians added a surreal silhouette against the backdrop of ultra-bright spotlights. I could not comprehend where we are, what has happened, why this picture of total devastation. As we look up ahead between the two pairs of train tracks, a few hundred meters away, we can see two factory chimneys with tall flames shooting from them, pillars of fire. At first we had the feeling of being in a bombed-out station. Those huge columns of flames coming out of the chimneys made me think we had arrived at some ironworks, or the entrance to Dante's Inferno. Despite his fear, Dr. Berner reassured his wife and children. The main thing is, the five of us will stay together, but we won't let anyone separate us. An SS officer stepped in front of them at that moment. Men to the right, women to the left. In an instant I was separated from my wife and children, recalled Berner. They shuffled forward in two parallel lines only feet apart. Come, my darling, and kiss us, his wife yelled out. I ran back to them. I kissed my wife and my children with tears in my eyes and my throat tightened up with grief, and I looked into my wife's eyes, wide, sad, beautiful, and filled with the fear of death. The children looked on in silence, following their mother. They could not comprehend what was going on. A soldier shoved Berner back to the men's line. In a few minutes, another shouted, Doctors, line up here! So Berner joined a small group assembling near several Red Cross trucks. There he watched as an immaculately groomed SS captain wearing white gloves stood at the front of thousands of new arrivals stretching a quarter mile along the tracks. As each approached, the SS officer gestured with one thumb to the right or left, splitting the crowd again. Only later would Berner learn that the officer was Josef Mengele, and that being sent to the left was an immediate death sentence. Standing a few steps behind Mengele was another SS officer, a short and stocky man with his back to Berner. He directed the prisoners after Mengele had made the selection. At one stage, that SS officer turned around. Berner was startled and shook his head and rubbed his eyes to be certain he was not mistaken. The SS major at Auschwitz's railhead was none other than Victor Capesius, a pharmacist from Berner's hometown. In the 1930s, Capesius had been a likable enough sales rep for IG Farben, the giant German chemical and industrial conglomerate. He had sold drugs for Farben's pharmaceutical subsidiary Bayer. Once the war started, I lost track of Capesius, recalled Berner, until my family and I arrived in Auschwitz. And who was there? The same Dr. Capesius. Berner slowly worked his way close enough so Capesius might hear him. The words spilled out fast. You remember me? He pleaded with Capesius to be reunited with his wife and 12-year-old daughter and 9-year-old twins. Twins? Capesius seemed interested. Capesius and another SS physician, Dr. Fritz Klein, retrieved Berner's wife and daughters. They took the family to Mengele, who was intently focused on the long lines of new prisoners. Klein told Mengele about the twins. Mengele was obsessed with sequestering twins for his experiments. But since the war had recently turned against the Reich, he knew he no longer had the luxury of taking every set of twins. Identical or fraternal? Mengele asked. Fraternal, Klein said. Later, Mengele waved him away. I don't have any time right now. They will just have to go back to their group, Capesius told a sobbing Berner. Don't cry. Your wife and children are just going to take baths. You will see them again in an hour. Berner was, in fact, dispatched to one of Auschwitz's slave labor subcamps. It was only after the war that he learned his family was gassed within an hour of their arrival. Two others recognized Capesius at the selection ramp that same day. Dr. Gisela Böhm, a pediatrician, and her 19-year-old daughter Ella, had arrived on the same train. Ella had comforted Berner's twins during the horrific journey. Both were startled to see Capesius at the railhead. Dr. Boehm also knew Capesius from when he was a buyer salesman. He had run a pharmacy in her hometown of Schesburg and made sales calls on her husband, also a doctor. Once he even showed them a buyer promotional film. Ella had fond memories of Capesius from when she was 12 and her father had introduced him to her as her pharmacist uncle. He had given her a buyer notepad as a gift. "I was very proud of my buyer pad," she recalled years later. "I bragged about it at school." Capesius sometimes relaxed with her family at a public pool, and Ella recalled he had been sweet to me. When Ella saw him, her first thought was that he might help separate her and her mother from the thousands of others. But she could not get his attention. "What is he doing here?" she wondered. "What is a pharmacist doing at a forlorn place like this?" Chapter 2. The Farben Connection. The answer to Ella's question was not simple. To understand what a pharmacist like Capesius was doing at Auschwitz, it is necessary to know first how the camp itself came to exist as a profit centre for medical experimentation, slave labour, and extermination. The deadly spawn of a military-industrial-political partnership between the Nazis and IG Farben, Germany's largest company. For Capesius in particular, that was more than merely a matter of understanding the dark history that led to Auschwitz. That is because before the war, Capesius worked for Farben and its pharmaceutical subsidiary Bayer. It was an affiliation that enhanced his standing among many of the Nazis who served with him at the camp. Interessengemeinschaft Farben, Syndicate of Common Interests Farben, was founded in December 1925, only 8 years before Hitler became Germany's Chancellor. Six leading chemical and pharmaceutical companies had merged to form the huge conglomerate. Among them were the world's largest synthetic dye makers Bayer, Höchst, BASF, and Agfa. In the 14 years from its inception to the start of World War II, Farben boasted a record of 4 Nobel Prizes in chemistry and medicine. It had a virtual monopoly on innovative patents at the forefront of manufacturing synthetic raw materials, including rubber and oil, as well as revolutionary medications to treat syphilis and malaria, patents on morphine and novocaine, even the exclusive rights to aspirin as a painkiller. Farben also boasted leading-edge research on thousands of wildly diverse products, from the artificial sweetener saccharin to potent poison gases and promising rocket fuels. Its 250,000 employees were better paid and more skilled than those in competitive industries. In record time, with its complex web of partnerships and subsidiaries, Farben had become the world's biggest chemical company and the fourth largest industrial conglomerate, close on the heels of General Motors, US Steel, and Standard Oil. It was, by a wide margin, Germany's most profitable firm. Even before Hitler came to power, he shared an unshakable belief widespread in Germany. The country had lost World War I largely because it had few natural resources needed to fight a prolonged military battle. Its vital industries ground to a virtual halt during World War I because a British naval blockade had strangled supply lines and prevented rubber, oil, steel, and nitrates from reaching Germany. This resulted in persistent shortages of everything from gunpowder to fuel, hobbling Germany on the battlefield. Ultimately, it was the raw materials shortage coupled with a widespread civilian hunger that had broken the German will to fight. Hitler, who was a decorated World War I soldier, was convinced the country had to be militarily self-sufficient. Farben Technologies offered Hitler a singular opportunity to rebuild Germany while no longer depending on other countries for oil, rubber and nitrates. But the marriage between the two, the up-and-coming right-wing nationalist and the monolithic company, was troubled early on. That was because many of Farben's best scientists, and about a third of its executive board, were Jewish. So there was a schizophrenic quality to the mating dance between Farben and the Third Reich. Nazi literature and commentators denigrated Farben as an instrument of international finance capital, code words for the Nazi view that a small Jewish cabal controlled and manipulated worldwide financial markets and industries. Sometimes Farben was mocked as IG Moloch, a reference to a Canaanite god to whom children were sacrificed. That was intended to conjure the centuries-old libel that Jews killed Christian babies and used their blood in religious rituals. the virulently anti-Semitic weekly Der Stürmer, ran cartoons of Isidora G. Farber, an offensive caricature seemingly a mixture of Shylock and a prostitute. Some of the harshest Nazi criticism was directed at Farben's pharmaceutical divisions since they routinely used laboratory animals for testing medications. Top Nazis were surprisingly hardcore animal rights activists, and Hitler was a vegetarian who hoped one day to ban all German slaughterhouses. The Nazis even passed laws to protect animals from hunters, to prohibit their use in films or circuses, and to outlaw kosher butchers. Germany was the first country to outlaw vivisection. The punishment for laboratory experiments with animals was commitment to a concentration camp, or in some cases, the death penalty. One of Farben's premier medical scientists, Heinrich Hölein, argued that animal experimentation was critical to the safety testing of life-saving medications. Nazis thought that such an opinion was merely further evidence that Farben was an international Jewish organization. Karl Bosch, the Nobel Prize-winning chemist who ran the company, was no fan of Hitler. Bosch considered the Nazis little better than political thugs who had no appreciation for the scientific innovation that was the backbone of Farben. But as Hitler started his climb to power, Bosch knew the company had to morph from an untrusted outsider to an indispensable partner. So Bosch opened up Farben's coffers and became the Nazis' biggest financial backer in the 1933 elections, in which Hitler gained nearly 6 million votes and solidified his position as Chancellor. Bosch also dispatched Farben's press secretary, someone who boasted solid Nazi connections, to make the case in Berlin that the company's leadership was mostly Christian self-made men. Hitler, meanwhile, took an intense personal interest in Farben's patents for synthetic oil. When he met two senior executives, the Führer surprised them by saying that Farben was at the heart of his plan to make Germany self-sufficient. When Bosch and Hitler had a summit in late 1933, the two initially bonded over a shared passion for a costly crash program for fuel independence. But the meeting ended on a sour note when Bosch raised concerns about the Nazis' accelerating exclusion of Jews from the sciences. Bosch was blunt. Both chemistry and physics would be set back 100 years if Germany forced its Jewish scientists to leave. That suggestion infuriated Hitler. "Then we'll work 100 years without physics and chemistry," he yelled. It put the two at odds. That year, the Nazis passed the Enabling Act, which gave Hitler the authority he would use to ban Jews from science and technology, teaching at universities, civil service jobs, and providing services to the government. Against the advice of his fellow directors, Bosch continued crusading for Jewish scientists. Small wonder that Hitler never again agreed to be in the same room as Bosch. The Nazis might have dismantled a company with less power and influence, but Hitler and his henchmen knew they needed Farben's know-how and muscle. So, starting in earnest in 1937, they did the one thing that would make it palatable to the Third Reich. Farben was Nazified. Robert Ley, a biochemist, became a Nazi minister in charge of the German labor front. All Jewish officials were dismissed. A third of the supervisory board of directors were forcibly removed from its headquarters and banned from any contact with the firm. Leading Jewish scientists in the research divisions were shunted aside and summarily replaced. By the time Jews were expunged from Farben's top ranks, Karl Bosch had become the firm's honorary chairman, a position with little influence. When he died 3 years later in the dual clutches of alcoholism and depression, he predicted to his doctors that Hitler would lead Germany to destruction. By July 1938, when the Third Reich decreed that even a single Jew on a board of directors made it a Jewish company, the tensions and backbiting between the Nazis and Farben were history. Many company officials had become Nazi Party members, and some had even joined the SS. Farben successfully applied for a certificate that certified it was a German firm in full compliance with the race laws. To demonstrate how seriously it viewed the directive to become an Aryan firm, Farben even dismissed 107 Jewish department heads that worked in international divisions outside Germany. And Farben had successfully converted its wholly owned American IG subsidiary into one of the Nazis' most effective spying resources in the US. With its ownership of film companies Agfa, Ansco, and General Annalen, its salesman obtained everything from photos of secret military installations to copies of classified Army and Air Force strategies. Hitler's annexation of Austria in March 1938 provided the first evidence of the extent to which the Farben-Third Reich partnership was in full bloom. Within weeks, Farben had seized control of Schodewerke Wetzler, Austria's largest chemical company in which Europe's preeminent banking family, the Rothschilds, owned a controlling interest. Farben moved in Aryan technicians and managers as all the company's top Jews were forcibly removed. Isidor Polak, Skoda's general manager, was literally kicked to death by a gang of Nazi stormtroopers. Farben's takeover of Skoda became the template it used in other countries that were the victims of Hitler's aggression. In 1938, during a standoff between Germany and Czechoslovakia, Farben used the threat of a Nazi invasion to buy Ausiger Verein, the largest Czech chemical company, at a fire sale price. By the time the Nazis began their blitzkrieg into Poland on September 1, 1939, Farben adjusted its loyalties inside the Third Reich to maximize its wartime spoils. Before the war, Luftwaffe chief Hermann Göring had been Farben's biggest supporter. When Poland fell to the Nazis, Farben allied itself most closely with SS chief Heinrich Himmler, who carried ultimate power when it came to the disposal of companies and properties there. That ensured it swooped up the three most significant Polish chemical and dyestuff firms. By June 1940, the Nazis had conquered Belgium, Denmark, Norway, the Netherlands, Luxembourg, and had stunningly brought France to its knees during a ferocious six-week assault. Many senior Farben executives had bitter memories of how the French had exacted huge reparations from German industry after World War I. Moreover, France's chemical industry had long been Germany's biggest competitor. The French firms were quickly Aryanized, and through a new holding company, Farben took control of France's prized chemical industry. Farben's ambitions grew in pace with the German battlefield victories. Directors drew up plans for carving up the chemical industries not only of occupied nations, but also of future conquests, including neutral Switzerland, then German allies, Italy and the Soviet Union, and even Britain and the United States. By now, the company provided a stunning 85% of the military goods the Nazis used in the war effort. The fall of France was to mark the zenith of German military success. Although the Nazis conducted a relentless air blitz against England, the British remained unbowed. Hitler then ignored the advice of his top generals and prepared to launch a second front in the east by invading Russia. The Nazi high command knew that the first year of fighting had already consumed large supplies of fuel and munitions. Even rubber, needed for everything from tires to combat boots, was running low, and a two-front war would put exponential demands on resources. Hitler demanded that Farben guarantee it could double its production of synthetic rubber and oil, requiring the construction of two new megaplants. Farben dispatched two teams to scout locations, one to southern Norway and the other to western Poland. Both were solidly under German control and safe from Allied attack. 39-year-old Otto Ambrose, a chemist widely recognized as Farben's synthetic rubber expert, had overseen the construction of the company's first large rubber plant at Schkopau in eastern Germany. After visiting Poland, Ambrose returned to the Frankfurt headquarters with news that he had found the ideal site to build both plants. It was in Polish Silesia, near the juncture of three rivers. Synthetic rubber and oil production required huge supplies of water for the high-pressure chemistry at the heart of both technologies. Three rail lines served the area. It was not far from a highway, and large mining districts were within a 20-mile radius. Another advantage, argued Ambrose, was that it was next door to where the Nazis were turning an abandoned cavalry depot into a concentration camp. That meant Farben could have access to a steady supply of cheap inmate labor. Ambrose's fellow directors quickly ratified the site, followed by an approval from the Third Reich. Farben decided to use the name of the small Polish village next door to its installation for its new corporate division, IG Auschwitz. Chapter 3. IG Auschwitz. Farben had big plans for IG Auschwitz. Not only would it be the company's largest complex, but for the first time would include an enormous hydrogenation facility to produce record amounts of synthetic rubber and fuel. The company expected IG Auschwitz to be a tremendous profit center. Farben was so confident that it declined the German government's offer of financing. If it had accepted Third Reich money, the Nazis would automatically have become Farben's partner. Instead, the directors wanted to assume all risks and reap all the profits. Farben set aside almost a billion Reichsmarks, about $55 billion in 2015, for its ambitious construction. The plans called for a sprawling facility several square miles in size, one that required more electricity than Berlin. SS Chief Heinrich Himmler considered the success of IG Auschwitz so important that he appointed his trusted chief of staff, SS Major General Karl Wolff, as the Farben SS go-between. On March the 20th, 1941, Wolff met in Berlin with the Farben chemist and director SS Lieutenant Colonel Heinrich Butterfisch. They wanted to sort out the details of how the neighbouring concentration camp at Auschwitz might help Farben. Many skilled workers were serving on the front lines as Nazi troops, so the company faced a shortage of experienced labourers. It planned on bringing in not only Germans, but what it euphemistically called free workers, employees from Holland, Belgium, France, as well as Poland, that were paid drastically reduced wages. Himmler ordered the inspector of concentration camps to provide upwards of 12,000 camp inmates. Since camps like Auschwitz were SS profit centres, Butterfisch knew that Himmler would insist on compensation for any inmates Farben used. After a half day of tough negotiations, Farben agreed to pay 4 Reichsmarks, then about $1.60, $20 in 2015, a day for skilled inmates, 3 for unskilled prisoners, and 1.50, 60 cents, for children. For that money, which eventually totaled more than $5 million, the SS agreed to provide transportation to and from the Auschwitz barracks, some 4 miles away from the construction site, as well as all rations. A few weeks after that deal was struck, several Farben directors gave Himmler a private tour of the IG Auschwitz construction site. He was impressed and promised a steady supply of camp inmates as labourers. Farben's Otto Ambros wrote in a memo, "Our new friendship with the SS is proving very profitable." Farben knew that the project's immense scope was a great technical challenge and that the constraints of war would make it tough to get all the raw materials. However, the construction proved even more problematic from the start, and the development quickly fell behind schedule. But IG Auschwitz was also plagued by an unexpected problem. Farben had not anticipated the terrible consequences for its workforce from the SS's savage punishment of inmates. Internal company memos catalogued the relentless abuses. They were severely flogged on the construction site, and sometimes kicked and beaten, even clubbed to death. One director noted, "This, the beatings, always applies to the weakest inmates who really cannot work harder. It not only kept the frailest ones from doing their work, but it had a generally demoralizing effect among the free workers as well as on the Germans. What's more, the daily march inmates made from Auschwitz drained them of much of their strength before they even started the workday. Wearing only ill-fitting wooden clogs and thin prison garb, they suffered in the extreme heat of summer and bone-chilling cold of the winters. Plant managers watched in dismay as it took 3, then 4, and finally 5 malnourished inmates to lift and carry 50-kilo bags of cement. Company executives complained internally that the SS did not understand what was necessary to make free enterprise flourish. But the obsessively bureaucratic Nazis demanded every forced labourer who left the main camp in the morning after a 4 a.m. roll call be accounted for at the evening one. That meant surreal scenes at the end of each workday when inmates dragged along the corpses of co-workers who had died during that shift to assemble at their cell block so that the Nazis could count the dead bodies as present. Several times a week, the Nazis trucked the piled corpses to the crematoriums. The bizarre ritual was rooted in profit. The SS made money from each cadaver, from extracting gold from dental fillings to using hair to fill mattresses and make warm socks for U-boat crews and Luftwaffe pilots. Disposing of dead labourers at Farben's plant would deprive the SS of the final opportunity to rape the corpses. Farben executives did not fret about the mistreatment of their inmate workers because of humanitarian concerns. Instead, they were frustrated that it took 3 prisoners to do the work that could be done by a single well-fed German worker. This kicked off a furious internal debate about how to jumpstart the stalled construction. Officials feared that if the synthetic rubber and oil plants did not fully supply Hitler's army, the SS would blame the company. No one wanted to risk incurring the wrath of Hitler and Himmler over wartime projects that were deemed indispensable. So in July 1942, a year into the fierce fighting on the Eastern Front, Farben's board approved a remarkable proposal that cemented its slide into moral bankruptcy. It decided the best way to resolve its IG Auschwitz labor problem was to build its own concentration camp at a cost of $20 million. The site selected was adjacent to its ongoing construction and just east of the original Auschwitz camp. Ernst Fritz Sauckel, the Reich's labor minister, gave Farben's proposal a green light, concluding that it was the best way to exploit the inmates to the highest possible extent at the lowest conceivable degree of expenditure. The new camp was named Monowitz Bunawerka, a combination of the Polish village, Monowice, Monowitz in German, that was demolished to make room for it, and Buna, German for synthetic rubber. Access to a steady supply of slave labourers would eventually encourage Farben and other German companies to build 45 sub-camps, coal mining, metalworks, chemicals, light industry, and even food processing, in a 30-mile radius as the Auschwitz footprint spread across the Polish countryside. Monowitz seemed to any casual observer simply a knockoff of Auschwitz, encircled with electrified barbed wire, watchtowers with machine gun-toting guards, patrolling dogs, and searchlights illuminating the camp nightly to prevent escapes. Monowitz had its own gallows, wretched solitary confinement cells, and a phalanx of former convicts who served as sadistic foremen of the slave labourers. There was also a brothel, Frauenblock, where female inmates were forced to work as sex slaves for the German workers. Farben even created a duplicate of the mocking iron sign that stood over the entrance to Auschwitz, Arbeit macht frei, work will make you free, the words taken from Dante's Inferno. Besides spending millions to build the camp, Farben agreed to cover all costs of food and housing while the SS took responsibility for security. The company did everything possible to boost its profits by cutting its costs. On average, three labourers were forced to sleep on wooden stalls originally designed to hold only one. Five times as many Jews were packed into barracks as were free German workers. The thin straw filling for the beds was a constant source of infection and illness, and the company aggressively experimented to determine the minimum amount of food required to keep inmates from starving while allowing them to work. The mainstay of the Monowitz diet was a watery soup the prisoners mocked as Buna, since it had a rubber aftertaste. The average forced labourer, existing on no more than 1,200 calories a day, lost about 9 pounds a week before stabilising as emaciated skin and bones. Company memos reveal that Farben officials figured that any inmates who died from the harsh work could be easily replaced with new prisoners on the next arriving train. Benjamin Ferenc, a chief American war crimes prosecutor after World War II, noted that the Jewish concentration camp workers were less than slaves. Slave masters care for their human property and try to preserve it. It was the Nazi plan and intention that the Jews would be used up and then burned. A problem Farben faced was that the SS sent most of the arriving prisoners straight to the gas chambers. Company executives griped, for instance, that in one shipment of 5,022 Jews, 4,092 had been killed immediately. After a formal complaint, the SS agreed to a rare accommodation by which some of the trains would be unloaded near IG Auschwitz, with an eye toward finding fit workers. On the first train unloaded near Monowitz, half of the 4,087 prisoners avoided the gas chambers and became slave labourers. Still, Farben managers noted their disappointment that the train contained so many women and children, as well as old Jews. Despite the unusual hurdles, top executives considered Monowitz to be a model for future projects. Chairman Karl Krauch wrote to Himmler on July 27, 1943, saying that he was particularly pleased to learn that in a discussion about a new synthetic rubber factory, the SS would continue sponsoring and aiding us, as was done at Auschwitz. Eventually, some 300,000 slave labourers passed through IG Auschwitz. It was there that Elie Wiesel and Primo Levi worked as young teens. Both survived and later became acclaimed writers, describing what happened there. Levi wrote that the Farben factory was a huge entanglement of iron, concrete, mud and smoke. It is the negation of beauty. Within its bounds not a blade of grass grows, and the soil is impregnated with the poisonous saps of coal and petroleum, and the only things alive are machines and slaves, and the former are more alive than the latter. About 25,000 of those forced labourers were literally worked to death, averaging a lifespan of only 3 months. By the end of the war, however, Farben's ambitious IG Auschwitz experiment was a strategic failure. Despite the enormous bankroll from Farben and the incredibly high human toll, to the complete dismay of Hitler, the plant managed to produce only a small amount of synthetic fuel and no Buna rubber. Its everlasting testament would be only of its murderous role in the final solution. Chapter 4. Enter Capesius. Victor Ernst Capesius was in many ways someone unlikely to end up at Auschwitz. He was not a native German or Austrian, the nationalities that dominated the soldiers, doctors and officers who staffed the concentration camps. Capesius was born on July 2, 1907, to devoutly German Lutheran parents in Reusmarkt, a Transylvanian town noted only for its close proximity to Vlad Dracula's medieval birthplace. His father was a physician and public health officer. Young Capesius had an unremarkable childhood. He was a quiet and unimpressive student at the local Lutheran school in Sibiu, a Romanian city with such a strong German character that most ethnic Germans called it Hermannstadt. Capesius finished in the middle of the 32 graduates. He earned his undergraduate degree in general pharmacology from King Ferdinand I University on June 30, 1930, located in the town of Cluj-Napoca, called Klausenberg by ethnic Germans. His first job was as an assistant in his uncle's pharmacy, the Apotheke zur Krone, Crown Pharmacy in nearby Sigisaura. Capesius's mother told him that one day he might inherit that business. He was only there 5 months before the Romanian army drafted him in 1931 as a first lieutenant and assigned him to Bucharest as a pharmacist assistant. But he soon managed to get extended leave to study chemistry at the University of Vienna. His time there overlapped with Hitler's rise to power in neighbouring Germany, something that could not have been lost on the young ethnic German student. It was in Vienna that Capesius met his future wife, 24-year-old Frederike Bauer. Fritzi, as Capesius called her, was also a student at the Institute of Pharmacology, and they both studied for their doctorate under the same professor, Dr. Richard Wasitzki. Fritzi found Capesius charming. When they started dating, she told her girlfriends that he was delightful. She liked everything about him, from his brown hair turning prematurely grey to his deep-set dark brown eyes. Some of her friends thought he seemed ungainly, but she corrected them, noting he was a wonderful dancer. They felt a common bond since both fathers were doctors. Their families were devout Lutherans, although Fritzi's father was a Jewish convert. In 1932, as their relationship flourished, she introduced him to her parents. Then Fritzi spent her semester break with him in Transylvania. Meanwhile, Capesius's dissertation about chenopodium, an herb used to treat people with parasitic worms, had earned him a pharmacy doctorate from the University of Vienna on November 30, 1933. When he returned to Sigisaura, he soon became the manager of his uncle's pharmacy. It was a profitable business, earning some 200,000 Reichsmarks annually, about $56,000 at a time when the average annual income in the US was $1,601. Many ethnic Germans in Romania were transfixed when Hitler became Chancellor of Germany that same year, but Capesius showed little interest in the upheaval gripping Germany. Although he joined a local nationalist social club, he seemed motivated more by the chance of making business contacts than fueling any political ardour. In his free time, he steered clear of the daily news and relaxed instead with friends. On Sundays, he could often be found with the Mild sisters, two pretty girls his age enjoying a picnic in a garden overflowing with wildflowers. He particularly liked traditional dishes such as...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.